The origin and the function of this wonderful flute player, and continue on with the history of these wonderful creations here. So, thank you, Philippe Beneath Press.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As you know, in the first part, we learned that opportunities emerged in the 19th century, taken up by bold creators who were often in similar and interconnected trades. They exhibit in World Fair, so I show you some picture of World Fair, the first one. Thus, clock makers, machine makers, and tool makers will become the new makers of the mechanical chimeras on the stage of the world fairs. To illustrate this inventive era, I would like to focus on the flute player automata from Théroud or from Roulet. That emblematic automaton, which, in spite of a complexity worthy of the previous century realization and an obvious decorative aspect, was produced in a very small but in a manufacturing context. In fact, three makers have been able over the years to claim the paternity of this musician. First, Alexandre Nicolas Théroud. Second, his nephew, Adolphe Fortuné Théroud. And the third, Jean Roulet. I pronounce the French words and French name by the French manner. Sorry. We also see what essential elements were brought to these three by the organ maker Pierre-Ernest Kelsen. So, after presenting the protagonist of our study and the project Genesis, we'll try to unravel the story and render to unto Caesar what is Caesar's. My work method has been to refer back to fundamental facts. I have set out to find documents in the archive of Paris from the period, and by analyzing the source to establish a chronology of pieces under scrutiny. Here are some biographies. First, Alexandre Nicolas Théroud, born in 1807. He was first associated with Mr. Varin in a toy business. Thanks to a substantial dowry from his wife, he set up his own business in 1832 as a toy manufacturer. After a first commercial failure in 1840, he turned to the manufacture of large automata and there found his market. In 1843, he took his first patent for the misbehaving rabbit, which had a great success. So, his participation in various exhibitions in Paris and abroad gained him universal prize, and he was considered one of the most important makers of mechanical toys on the occasion of the 1849 Paris World Fair, as one spokesman of the jury wrote. In 1855, he received the silver medal at the Paris Next Exhibition. In London, in 1862, he exhibited for the first time the automaton driven by mechanical organ designed in collaboration with Pierre Ernest Kelsen. He was, at this moment, at the top of the entrepreneurial ladder and got several medals. However, a series of mishaps due to the Franco-Prussian War of 1870, the Paris Commune of 1871, and the death of his first wife led to a second business collapse in January 1878. We have the luck to find the bankruptcy report. And when we read it, three significant elements appear clearly. So, first, the inventory of the wool workshop. Among toys, dolls, and spare parts, mechanisms for flute players are clearly described. Second, the list of the 24 creditors. Don't close. Among several suppliers, strangely, appears the name of Julie Théroud. Who is she? We don't know. Cousin, sister, daughter? No, daughter, no, impossible. No child. Julie Théroux. She loses 4046 French francs at this moment. The second one, among the other, second one is Georges Wall, a former cabinet maker. The third one is Pierre Ernest Kelsen, the organ maker. Moreover, the most amazing is the appearance of the name of the nephew, Adolphe Fortuné Théroud. Third, by special agreement of the liquidator, our man kept the ownership of his tooling. What happened to this man who was 71 years old at this moment? If from 32 to 77 include, the commercial directories mentioned the existence of Alexandre Nicolas Théroud, in 1878 there appears a new firm with quite the same name. Oh. Théroud and Company. Indeed, in August 78, a limited liability company is created, associating a certain A. Théroud with Georges Wall, one of the previous Théroud employees and creditor. Was he the man who helped the collapsed firm injecting some capitals which enabled Théroud to recover his tooling and restart production? Or was this the start of an independent activity for Alexandre Fortuné Théroud? Born in 1822, he was an apprentice in the family business and worked his way up to the position of foreman in 1845. According to a spokesman of the 1855 World Fair, Paris World Fair, he was a skilled and intelligent workman who contributed greatly to the success of the automata which had made the reputation of his employer. For this, he received a medal in 1855. He again received a medal in the 1867 exhibition, at which his uncle also received prizes for his automata and mechanical toys. His own son, Emile Gustave, born in 1852, became also apprentice in this shop. As his faithful employees during all those years of success, we may suppose that their uncle willingly allowed them to set up a new business based on the old one. So, it's not surprising then that this new company name appeared in the Directory of Commerce in 1879. The new address, together with a mention of the medal of 55 and 67, are confirmation that the nephew of 57 years old is now taking up the management of this new legal entity. In his turn, Emile, the son, took over the management from 1889 to 1997 until the business was sold. I turn now to Jean Roulet, born in 1829. After arriving in Paris, Jean Roulet started as a toolmaker in 1865, using his wife's dowry. During this creative century, it seems to be very important to contract a good wedding.
Still is.
Today, too. Toolmaking was a particularly important trade, since it was the basis of all mechanical components integrated into the Parisian district of fancy goods manufacture, and which led him into contact with all the important manufacturers in the field. We may well suppose that Jean Roulet knew Théroud, maybe even worked for him. Cosette Bellancourt, his granddaughter, said. Remember in 67, after meeting Joseph Lamour, another French crimper who was known to spend his leisure time on mechanics, Jean Roulet made the parts of a so-called working gardener, which was highly successful and, in fact, became the trademark of the future business. The main characteristic of his manufacturing processes is democratizing cheap toys. He used the techniques of die cutting and stamping, bringing in mass production and greatly reduced prices. At the age of 49, he exhibited at the 1708 Paris World Fair for the first time and published his first known catalogue. On the front page of this booklet appears the flute player automaton which so intrigues us. This implicit claim means that for about 60 years, the period corresponding to the establishment of the first contemporary collection, the paternity of this automaton falls to Jean Roulet and only to him. Now we come to the heart of the subject, and I hope that this study will shed some light upon it. The last actor of this thriller is Pierre Ernest Kelsen. In fact, we suppose he arrived from Austria. He succeeded to the D'Averville family, and he exercised his talent from 1845. He drew the attention of the jury of the 1855 exhibition with a cylinder organ driven by a clockwork mechanism which moved the keys. The collaboration with Théroud began at least from April 1858, the date of patent number 36365 for the manufacture of an automaton. He won several medals, of course. The project. The genesis of the project. First, I let you read an extract from Toys and What Is Inside Them, a book from Henri Nicole in 1868. And he explained that it's the tradition of Vaucanson automata to play flute. Perhaps along the line of that of Vaucanson, whose fame was still strong, the two partners had the idea of an automaton which used the skill of both of them. It would be a flute player. A patent was requested on the 24th of October 1866. For the decorative covering, both makers take up the useful feature of an antique Roman effect from Le Louvre. The cardboard body assumes the general position of the marble original. The tree stump for strength and an armature of wood and iron to hold it up. No doubt, for commercial reasons, and to satisfy the exotic taste of a metropolitan clientele, the original white child took on the color of the inhabitant of the French, of the distant French colonies. And the prudery of the bourgeoisie at this time led them to the panther furs being replaced by clothing more in line with the oriental taste of the period. Now, let's have a look at a comparative study. The mechanism inserted into the torso of the android drove all the essential functions, in particular the fingers of the two hands, and more classically the movements of the head, the eyes, and the eyelids. The handle winds a spring enclosed in a barrel to supply the energy. Thus, there are four tunes inscribed on the cylinder, playing popular melodies. What is more worthy is that the wooden cylinder contains a drive spring, saving much space. We look first at the mechanics before the musical parts. In the example of the young boys, the cage for the mechanism is clearly derived from clockmaking, since it comprises an armature made from thick brass sheet assembled with steel spacer, chamfered and finished off. For comparison, here on the left is a regulator mechanism from the residential organ by Kelsen we saw just before. This regulator shows similarities in conception, construction, material and fitting with the mechanism of the flute player, of which we see an example on the right. The same type of brass sheet, the same design, in fact. In the only known later female example, the general framework of the body is made of bent steel sheet. But it's later. Even if the general shape is identical, the construction is much less well finished and the linkages between the different components are in bent tinplate. To produce the sound, Théroud had chosen to insert a mechanical organ into the chest of the figure, though the contribution of an organ builder is necessary. Comparing the sound-mounted flutes, Viennese type, of the different examples, and the residential organ spoken of before, we find that the two rows of instruments are on the same wood. Their general construction is identical. The fitting of the feet is similar. The range of sound is similar. The mouths are cut the same. All this leads us to conclude that they are of this common origin. The memory. Here, comparisons are more difficult. In the example studied, the cylinder is of wood turned around the central core, then covered in paper. This is the cylinder of the residential organ. Apart from the insertion of the drive spring inside the cylinder, this technique is common to many makers, and as the materials are all very similar, it's not possible to ascertain different provenance. So, the cylinder of the flute player, this one. So, we do confirm the organ and wind mechanism, the keys and the cylinder form a coherent ensemble, as supplied by an organ builder, which could logically be Kelsen. So, we find ourselves with several automatas, similar but not absolutely identical, coming from the same patent, and the question remains of the attribution to one or the other maker. With no document attesting the origin and date, we have kept to the method of dating from the repertoire. The cylinders are generally considered to play the popular melodies of the time. So, they are acknowledged markers by which to define a cutoff date. Sorry. To get a clearer picture, let's call upon this example and ask them the question. Number one, the only known example signed is in the Merton Guinness collection in Morristown Museum in New Jersey. Thanks to Jerry and Steve Ryder and by courtesy of the museum, we have some picture and perhaps more, but point. Engraved into a fixing bracket just here, from the red arrow, you have the inscription Théroud and Company, Paris, breveté. The meaning is patent. Its repertoire, the five line in the black, it's situated around 1869. What? 54, 69. It's not possible to make this organ before, of course. It's repertoire, so it's situated around 69, showing it to be among the earliest examples. The patent dates from 66. Also, it is the only one standing upon a rectangular base which appears to be completely authentic. And I thank very much Steve and Jerry Ryder, who share with me this important information. Number two, we talk about with Mr. Wolf. Number two was sold in a Skinner auction. Today in Russia, it bears the mark of the Parisian retailer Jouet et Tabletterie, Toys and Object of Virtue, Maison Simone, Simone Firm, Passage de l'Orme, de l'Orme Street, Rue de Rivoli, Rivoli Street, 188. The house is closed now. At present, it formed a couple with the chief player of the Pan Pipes sold at chart with a number four. The Pine Pipe, the she player Pine Pipes, we saw just before. Its repertoire is around 77-78. It's thus one of the first examples made after the collapse of the business. Of the sound, but I take this video because it's a video on the last convention in Orlando in the Marc Yaffe collection. And second time, sorry, I forget the sound of the first one, and we have to go back to have. Is Les Fauvettes, Polka de Narcisse Bouquet, 1869. Number three. Number three from a private collection, now lost from sight. He was redressed by Mrs. Cosette Descamps-Bellancourt before 1995, and all I can talk about is the flute does not appear to be the original. Number four, also from another private collection in America today, he was sold at Chartres in 2001. He was part of the original couple, was then Sipard, and the lady sold to be associated with the number two. The number five. The number five was previously owned by John Tager, an American in Paris. Not from the movie, from it was a dentist or something like that. He died 30 years ago, and his collection was gone away for a long time and appeared recently. Its repertoire is around the year 77-78, indicating a date of manufacture of 78. It's thus another of the first examples made after the collapse of the business. And perhaps we have some music? No?
Or yes.
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 It's not my job. By your assistants.
It's a drum.
As me, like me.
It's a drum. C'est le tambour.
Yeah.
Drums.
Number six, named Cocagé. He is today in the Bob Gilson collection. And the particular skin color of this example, its characteristic repertoire, its costume, and even in its Bern origin, lead one to assume it was a special order from an Austrian connoisseur. It's probable that the cylinders were customized. According to the taste of the client, this would explain the repertoire of this one. Kartner Liedermarkt, music from Carinthy, small area in Austria, and the other. One indicates a date of manufacture of 1884. I have no music for this one, and the black and white picture are to express the white color of the skin, of course. Number seven, lost after an auction in UK, and two or perhaps three, or it's difficult, more, are lost from sight today. It was difficult to track these scarce automata as they could be redressed when changing owners. At first glance, there is a little aesthetic difference between the models apart from the clothes. If we look at the first four images from the left, it's easy to see that the general posture of the body, casually leaning against the tree stump, brings the weight on the right leg, the left one being crossed in front, as in the Roman marble.
This one is not very okay.
And the fifth, that the arm held against the chest, bring the transverse flip up to the lips, ready to play. The fifth example, on the contrary, has a slightly different position of the leg. As shown by the previous hall of screws, the position was changed from the original during a previous previous restoration, and now, for an indefinite reason, the left leg is bent toward the rear. As a result, the often heard argument we differentiate the manufacturer because of the position of legs does not hold. The base is oval in 5 cases out of 6 and rectangular in the first one, number 1. Number 3 show support to the tree stump here, probably added later. And the skin color is black for some, more golden in number 4, and exceptionally white in number 6. And so, to conclude, regarding the biographic elements and the comparative study of the models we approach, we may reasonably put forward 3 theories. Alexandre Nicolas Théroude, who undoubtedly conceived the original, for whom we have a 1866 patent, still the owner of his tooling in 1878, would have been able to restart manufacturing to finish the work in progress, while leaving the sales side to another commercial structure. This theory does not appeal to us, since these automata were made until at least 1886. By then, our man would have reached the age of 79. The second hypothesis would claim that the flutists made after the business collapsed in 78 were unfinished models from the workshop of Alexandre Nicolas Théroude, to be completed in the factory of Jean Roulet. Were these pieces bought by him after the bankruptcy? He was installed in a neighboring workshop, a professionally well-established in the fancy good business, an opportunistic creator and businessman, no doubt familiar with all the latest business techniques. It cannot be excluded that he took a part of the stock of his unfortunate neighbor in order to shine on the opportunity of the great Parisian show of 78. At the age of 49, Jean Roulet, wishing to extend his business on the minds of the visitor to the 78 Paris World Fair, he produces his first catalog with the subject of our study on the very front page. Amazing, no? The last proposition is a compromise between the first two. Adolphe Fortuné Théroude, the nephew, having participated in the workshop projects, is the best placed to relaunch manufacturing using his uncle's stock via the firm he established in 78. Of course, he set up a workshop listed in professional directories, as we see before, from 79 to 97. This should have led him to sign his work. But this technician is more a design office creator interested in making animated scenes from the great department store, which are just appearing, rather than doing business. Finally, despite the appearance of the flute player in the Roulet catalog, which seems to contradict the continuation of the Théroude production, We may assume that manufacturing of the flute player remained, at least for a time, in the hands of the Terut family, the nephew, in fact, and that sales were managed by Jean Roulet. Jean Roulet used this emblematic figure as a masterhead for his own production and to develop the prestige of his own firm. Thank you very much for following me in this journey.
You have to transport this magnificent. How would you do that?
By Air France. We are organ builder from 37 years ago now, and since we learned to make crates, okay. First, tout d'abord, in the beginning we learned to make crates, so we can export to America all you want. No, we put this automaton in a double crate. The first one with smooth parts, and the first crate is in the second one, a larger one with foam all around. So he is able to play another time for you now.
He has quite a smile.
Yeah,
I know
he looks at you at the end.
He's got to play with that a bit.
Several pictures of inside. It's an organ. It's an organ in the chest, so it's just usual for an organ
builder. Oh, two tunes.
Yeah.
Four.
In fact, you have the luck in America to get. No, three of them. One now in Russia, three in America, and two in Europe.
Talk to you later. I know there's another one.
Sure. I have some picture more, but probably it's the first, the second, or the third one. It's difficult to develop several pictures.
I might even have a picture here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I appreciate all participation. when we study something, a subject like this, they never end. You can explore all the year long or the lifelong subject like this. Sorry, my English is not very accurate, and I have some difficulties with the pronunciation. But it seems to be in the beginning. I think it's more. It's easier for you to learn French than for me to speak English. But you miss the first part, so I am obliged to speak English. Sorry.
Okay.
Thank you.